I like to think of horticulture as a true Renaissance profession, i.e. one that seamlessly interweaves science and beauty. But I know what some of you are thinking. Horticulture, that's gardening, and this is gardening, isn't it? So if you are so inclined, can I just present a little bit of evidence to the contrary? So horticulturalists get involved in what's known as ex situ plant conservation. That is, collecting seed from wild plants under threat, bringing them back and either conserving them in our living collections or banking them, that is, chilling them down to minus 20 degrees centigrade, where they can be stored in perpetuity, or perhaps until such time as the plant is no longer under threat and can be reintroduced. So with this great burden of responsibility, it's important that we are ingenious growers of plants. And indeed, we've worked out ways to make the stubborn, the reluctant, the hard to grow straightforward. Here we have some Hespero yucca whipplii seedlings in what we call a growth chamber. Now, a growth chamber is a most ingenious device. It precisely manipulates light, heat, and humidity to create an optimal growing environment. And when we're briefly dwelling upon growing conditions, let's talk about the stuff that they're growing in, which we might colloquially refer to as compost. Well, in terms of replicating the extraordinary variety of wild conditions our plants come from, this is where horticulturists become sort of biological alchemists, if you like. They can replicate any number of conditions, really by combining nothing more than organic matter, loam, and minerals. The organization I work for has something as niche as a Madagascan humid forest mix. So I work at Wakehurst. Now, Wakehurst is a 535-acre botanic garden and estate, and it is run by the Royal Botanic Gardens Kew, who are a global resource for plant and fungal knowledge. And I think Wakehurst is wonderful, I would, wouldn't I? It's a place of wide, epic vistas and exquisite, intimate spaces. But like a lot of big designed landscapes, we've got a couple of really notable areas that have reached the end of their natural design lives. Does anyone know that feeling? and we are presented with the most marvelous opportunity, the chance to create something new, and the chance to ask ourselves, well, right now, what should a botanic garden do when it comes to design? What should we embody? And I'll go back to the beginning of the talk. For me, it's science and it's beauty. The science, well, Kew's global scientific work is our USP, and we need to embody that in what we do. We need to choose plants that will tell stories, plants that are under threat in the wild, that can tell us a conservation story. Plants that perhaps have a great value as food or medicine or in manufacturing or for fibers that can tell an economic story, or plants that can link us back to when the world was a very, very different place that can tell an evolutionary story. And beauty, well, to be vulgar about it, beauty sells, doesn't it? Beauty is the thing that can enable a garden to transcend its kind of physical space and pop up in your social media feed or the newspaper you've chosen to read. Beauty is the thing that might convince someone with previously no interest in gardens or science to come and see us at Wakehurst. And I thought it was worth just having a brief meditation on beauty in the landscape. So if you can please prepare yourself for a short historical interlude. So I did say beauty, didn't I? So for me, mankind's relationship with beauty in the landscape has swung pendulum-like through the centuries between two poles, one we might describe as wild and the other mannered. And this is a bomazzo in central Italy, created in the sort of mid to late 16th centuries. It's sometimes known as the Garden of Monsters, or perhaps more appropriately, the Sacro Bosco, the sacred wood. And this was a garden designed for you to feel something, to have an emotional or perhaps even spiritual reaction. But we'll go forward 100 years to the Netherlands, and this is the Dutch take on a parterre. Now, what's happened to wild here? It's been reduced down to a sort of single decorative ribbon. It's fighting for attention with a series of coloured gravels. But just a few decades later, along comes Capability Brown. Has anyone heard that name this year? Yeah. So Capability Brown, he lets the wild breathe again. This is the designed landscape as an analogue of nature. It's soothing, it's bucolic, but actually for some, it's bland and monotonous. So a whole movement rises up against capability brown, the picturesque. They demand colour, texture and variety in their landscapes. There's even briefly a militant faction, the sublime, and they want their landscapes to be ever so slightly terrifying. Now this is Hawkstone in Shropshire, one of the few surviving sublime landscapes in the country. And even now, it is a distinctly edgy experience. When I took my children, I clung to them tightly throughout. Right, beginning of the 20th century now, and this is Hestercombe in Somerset, created by the dynamic design duo Gertrude Jekyll and Edwin Lutyens. So Lutyens is the architect, and he lays out crisp lines of stone and water within which Jekyll's planting can be ever so slightly wild. And to the modern day, now we call this the naturalistic movement. It actually has many different expressions, but primarily it's plants performing their fundamental ecological function, albeit under the auspices of an aesthetically driven design. Now this is Pete Udolph's Highline in New York, much talked about. So beauty is this thing that creates what I could pretentiously call an emotional transaction between myself, the garden curator, and you, the garden visitor. And perhaps in the heart of that transaction, you may be more inclined for me to share a fact or two about Kew's scientific work with you. If I've really got you hooked, perhaps you start supporting the cause that I work for. So back to Wakehurst, two really significant landscapes in need of complete renewal, a Southern Hemisphere landscape and an Asian landscape. How can we embody science and beauty into those two areas? So for the Southern Hemisphere, well, what about Gondwana, that great southern landmass that, as it split into its constituent continents not that long ago, it tore whole plant families apart, plant families that are still now growing on opposite sides of the world. So Wakehurst has a long history of Gondwana. In fact, back in the 1920s and 30s, our plant hunters brought back plants from Chile and Tasmania and found that they thrived in our soil, and that they had a complementary aesthetic. So our Southern Hemisphere proposal is a concept, reunites Gondwana in all of its diversity and variety, but ultimately coherence. These are plants with a fundamental genetic memory of growing side by side. And what about the beauty? Where does that come in? Well, let's take a South African bulb meadow, which is the proposed centerpiece. So bulb meadows happen in the wild in South Africa primarily after bushfires. So as the final sort of cinders fade away from burnt scrub, a vast subterranean community of geophytes, that's bulbs, corms and tubers, leap forth, colonizing the new space that's been provided for them. It's a very dynamic moment. And imagine that aesthetic translated back into a designed landscape. Endless hundreds of square meters of naturalized bulbs, things like Watsonias or Agapanthus or Nyphophia, the red hot poker plant. Now just think of the marketing potential. Come and see our red hot poker meadow before it fades away. So on to Asia. Now when we were developing the concepts for Asia, one strong theme kept emerging, that of the Silk Road. The Silk Road is an anthropological concept, but also as a botanical concept. The Silk Road that acted as a conduit for plants of extraordinary economic value, tea, apples, rice, and ginger, but also the Silk Road as a host for the most amazing, botanically interesting, but beautiful plants. So our Silk Road concept connects visitors back to the wild relatives of those plants of immense economic value. And that forms a backdrop for the centerpiece, a Silk Road step, a vast, immersive, flowering landscape filled with all of the most extraordinary plants from the Caucasus through Central Asian countries such as Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan and into the west of China. Tulips, iris, alliums, geraniums, salvias, all naturalized, all performing that fundamental ecological function which they remember from the wild. And one final plant, Eremirus, the fox tail lily. So this is a mountainside of foxtail lilies, and this was photographed in Kyrgyzstan this summer. Now, Kyrgyzstan is a country with an amazing botanical tale to tell. It has more species of plant than the whole of Europe put together, and it's one we want to tell at Wakehurst. So next summer, Wakehurst horticulturalists will be out in Kyrgyzstan, collecting seed from mountainsides like this, and raising the plants back in our nursery to create a new Asian landscape, one that I hope will embody both science and beauty, and one that I hope will win your hearts and minds. Thank you for listening.